Exchange Church. Good morning, good morning, good morning. How are you? Man, that's actually really good. That's awesome. Why don't you stand on up with us? Say hello to three people. We'll just keep it low key. Stand up, say hi to a few people beside you. Yeah, yeah. Hi, how are you? Hi, good to see you. Good to see you. Anyone excited to worship God this morning? Come on, let's go. Give him a shout of praise this morning. Yeah, he's good. Amen. I tried to get my wife to come do announcements today. She wasn't having it. She was actually supposed to lead worship with me this morning, but she's not feeling too well. So be praying for Andy. She was up all last night watching TV. I think that's what the problem is. No, we love you. Just be praying for her health. That'd be amazing. But who's just happy to be in the house of the Lord this morning? Anyone? Man, I love his church. I love our church. I love our church family. I've been praying these days that God would continue to grow you. And I would love to know again that God is working on the inside of our hearts so that we could reach out, so that we could be confident in who we are and who he's created us to be. And again, welcome people into environments like this. Amen. So I'm glad that he's doing a work in your heart, doing a work in your life. And you know this next song we're going to sing. It's called Nothing Else. And I don't know how you've come into this place. If, again, good week, bad week, just kind of going through the motions. But if this is a moment where you just kind of need to say sorry to God for putting him second, for not choosing the right heart, come on, somebody. This is a great opportunity. So we're just going to continue in our worship. And yeah, he's good. Amen.
Caught up in your presence, I just wanna sit here at your feet. I'm caught up in this holy moment. I never wanna leave. Oh, I'm not here for bliss. Jesus, you don't know me anything more than anything that you can do. I just want you.
Don't sing, I'm sorry.
And I'm sorry when I've just gone through the motions. I'm sorry when I just sang another song. Take me back to where we started. I open up my heart to you.
Come on, open up your heart to him this morning.
And I'm sorry when I come with my agenda. I'm sorry when I forgot that you're enough. Take me back to where we started. I open up my heart to you.
Come on, could you raise your hands to your God this morning?
I'm caught up in your presence. I just wanna sit here at your feet. I'm caught up in this holy moment. I never want to leave.
We love you, God. I'm not here.
And I'm not here for blessings. And Jesus, you don't know. Just go through the motions. I'm sorry when I just sang another song. Take me back to where we started. I open up my heart to you. just want you and nothing else. Nothing else, nothing else will do. I just want you, nothing else.
Come on, tell them this morning.
Nothing else, come on, declare it. Nothing else will do. I just want you, nothing else.
Nothing else will do this morning, God. Nothing else will do. Forgive us for the times when we put something else before your presence. Nothing else will satisfy, God. Nothing else will quench this thirst, God. It's you and you alone, God. Yeah.
Nothing else. Oh.
Praise this morning. Come on, he's worthy.
Christ is my firm foundation. He's the rock on which I stand. When everything around me is shaken, I've never
sing it out.
So why would he fail now?
Come on, we know
he won't. He won't. I still got joy in chaos. I got peace that makes no sense. So I won't. Christ is my firm foundation.
Come on, is someone thankful this morning? Come on, he's worthy. He's worthy. You've never failed us, God. You've never failed us, Lord. The rain came, the wind blew, but my house was built on you. And I'm safe with you. I'm gonna make it just because of you, God. The rain came, the wind blew, my house was built. He's worthy, amen. Hey, why don't you welcome Chris Brookbanks as he comes and gives some announcements. High five someone, hug someone.
6:30. Good morning. Happy Father's Day to all the dads, spiritual fathers, fathers-to-be. Let me get in the camera. Thanks for joining us this morning. So happy you guys are here. My name's Chris. I've got a couple announcements for you. So first of all, if you haven't done so already, make sure you check us out on socials, Instagram, Facebook. That's where we're going to keep you updated with everything going on in the life of Exchange at exchange.church. We've got some prayer and praise cards in the cup holders in the seats beside you guys. If you're new, some connect cards as well. We would absolutely love for you guys to fill those out so we can get to know you a little bit better. If there's any space in your life where we can be walking with you in prayer, or you know, any praise reports anywhere where God's moving in your lives, we love to partner with you guys in that. So feel free to drop those into the offering bucket on the way out. If you have come prepared with an offering this morning, thank you so much. We're very grateful to be part of such a generous and giving church. There's a couple ways you guys can give this morning. You can head over to the website or send an e-transfer to give at exchange, ecwindsor.com, something like that. I don't know. It's been a while. you can drop it into the offering bucket once again on the way out. We have a team night coming up on Tuesday at 6:30. 6 p.m. to be safe, Micmac Park. It's going to be a great time. I think we're going to have some food, play some games. We've got probably some spike ball and other fun games. So make sure you guys come on out, all in team night. We would absolutely love to see all of you guys out there at Micmac Park. And keep an eye on the socials, Facebook and Instagram, and we'll post more info about that as well. But yeah, we'd love to see all you guys come out on Tuesday. Let me pray and we'll get back into it. So Lord, thank you that we can get together this morning and just praise you and celebrate you. And thanks for all the dads, Lord. Thanks for the spiritual fathers and the guidance by all of the fathers in the room this morning and not in the room. I pray that you would speak into our lives this morning. Let us hear the things that you want us to hear. And let us worship you in the coming worship the way that you deserve it this morning, Lord. And I pray for a great Sunday and a great week ahead. In Jesus' name, amen. You guys can stand.
A big happy Father's Day to Chris Brookbanks. Good job, Chris. So good. I think Rachel's just shaking her head. Man, yeah, just such a great sense of freedom and liberty in this room this morning as we worship him. We've got one more song, and then we're just going to lean into his word. But, man, I don't know if you sense it, but I just believe that the Holy Spirit's working right now. So come on, do you trust him this morning? Come on, do you trust him? Come on, let's lean in. Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. He's been my fourth man in the fire, time after time. Born of his spirit, washed in his blood. And what he did for me on Calvary is more than enough. Come on, I trust. I trust in God, my Savior, the one who will never fail. He will never fail. Trust in God, my Savior, the one who will never fail. He will never fail. Perfect submission, all is at rest. I know the author of tomorrow has ordered my steps. Come on. So this is my story. Come on. And this is my song. I'm praising my risen King and Savior all the day long. Come on, I trust. I trust in God, my Savior, the one who will never fail. He will never fail. I trust in God, my Savior, the one who will never fail. sing this out. 'Cause I sought the Lord, and he heard, and he answered. I sought the Lord, and he heard, and he answered. I sought the Lord, and he heard, and he answered. And that's why I trust him. That's why I trust him. I sought the Lord, and he heard, and he answered. I sought the Lord, and he heard, and he answered. I sought the Lord, and he heard, and he answered. That's why I trust him. That's why I trust him. I sought the Lord, and he heard, and he answered. I sought the Lord, and he heard, and he answered. I sought the Lord, and he heard, and he answered. That's why I trust him. That's why I trust him, God. And my Savior, the one who will never fail. He will never fail. You'll never fail us, God. I trust in God. My Savior, the one who will have a feeling that maybe this has been the first time in a while that anyone's actually sought the Lord, and you're like, oh shoot, can I actually sing this part? Like, am I allowed to sing this part? Come on, if you seek him right now, you will find him. The Bible says you knock and that door is going to be open to you this morning. So why are you waiting? Why are you spectating this morning? Come on, seek him, and he wants to be found this morning. And you are found in his presence, and you're found in his goodness. So come on, why wait? Why wait? Go after him. Yeah. That's why I trust him. That's why I trust him. I sought the Lord, and he heard, and he answered. I sought the Lord, and he heard, and he answered. I sought the Lord, and he heard, and he answered. That's why I trust him. That's why I trust in God. He's my Savior, the one. Come on, sing it out. I trust in God. And so we do. We trust you this morning, God. Come on, why don't you just raise your hands all over this place, because I really believe that God is doing work, and I really believe that God is stretching some faith and stretching some people. Maybe this feels awkward. Maybe you have this like predisposition to not doing this. Come on, just raise your hands just in an act of faith as we seek him, as he wants to be found this morning. We raise our hands high in surrender, high in praise, high in adoration to the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, the best father, the best dad that there's ever been, that there ever will be. And so we trust you, God. We trust you with our circumstance. We trust you in the good times, and we trust you in the hard times. And we trust you right now that even we're making a choice to worship you. And maybe for someone that's a hard choice this morning, God, that you will bring blessing, that you will bring grace and mercy, because that's who you are and that's what you do for us, because you're a good father. And so we love you this morning and we trust in you. And so we give you these next few moments. I pray that as we dive into your word, Holy Spirit, again, you would reveal yourself to us like only you can. We love you and we thank you for all that you're doing in this moment. In Jesus' name, everyone said, amen. Come on, everybody said, amen, amen, amen. You guys can grab a seat. I'm going to grab my little table, my trusty table. Man, did you guys hear Tristan's harmonies, by the way? I was like, shoot, so good, so good. The band was good this morning. Love you guys. You guys are incredible. By the way, is Zoe Amelia in the room, or is she serving in kids? She's serving. That's good, because she doesn't want to listen to me. She hears me enough. Yeah, but Zoe was actually, she was helping Riach on lyrics this morning, and so I love seeing the junior highs kind of lean in. We have a couple new people for the first time this morning serving in Kidsmen for the first time, so that's really cool. And happy Father's Day. Brad's like, are you sure that's what your beverage of choice will be? If I burp, just pretend it's the Holy Spirit, okay? It'll be, can we ever have them fun? Come on. It's good. Welcome to church. So good to see you guys. I had such an incredible week. This was a busy week for me, meeting with a lot of people and, you know, just getting some time in and chatting with some people. And really, one of the first kind of, you know, sit downs I had this week was talking with a guy who was like, this sermon series is absolutely kicking my butt. Like, in the best way possible. Can I get an amen for that? Amen. Like, I know that, you know, as I've been leaning in and I've been, you know, studying and just preparing my heart for where we've been and where we're going, man, God is just revealing himself. And also, this is what I recognize, and this is not in my notes, but I also recognize that when we're aware of the choices that God is calling us to make, that's when the enemy wants to slide in and get us off track more than ever. We're not giving him more of a platform than he deserves this morning. But there's an awareness that when you start to choose the right hard, the enemy goes, okay, now I'm in trouble. Come on, somebody. Now I'm in trouble. So he's going to come in and he's going to sneak in. And maybe he's going to be whispering those lies to you from the past. Or maybe he's going to drudge up something from the past that triggers you in such a way. Or he's going to come after that relationship. Or he's going, whatever that is. And so again, our firm foundation, our unshakable ground, which gives us unshakable faith this morning, is Jesus Christ. And we are who he says we are. Amen. We are who he says we are. And so that's our stance this morning. And we continue to choose your heart, choose the right heart. So I don't know about you, but I've been having a blast these past few weeks. And again, if you are new, and you don't know who I am, maybe you're finding this online. Hello. My name is Drew Riach, lead pastor here at Exchange. And we are just, again, so glad that you've been following along with us in a series called Choose Your Heart. And I really do believe that as we lean into this and as we have been, one of the things that we said in small group a couple weeks ago is that actually when we choose the way of Jesus Christ, the Bible says that his burden is... Ooh, someone's a scholar. I love it. His burden, yeah, he is in my small group. Cheater. His burden is light. Like, we get this mindset like, man, I don't know if I can do it. Or I don't know if I can choose this. I don't know if I have it in me to do the hard work. The Bible says that his burden is light. So if you're in a space where you're wanting to step out and you've been following with us and wanting to take new steps of faith, can I encourage you to step out and do that? Because you're not doing it in your own strength when you choose his way. Amen? You're not doing it in your own way when you step out in faith. The Bible actually says that he's going to help you carry that burden. He's going to help you carry the thing that you feel like you cannot do. And you know what? You probably can't. And so that's why we need Jesus. So again, what we've been talking about is we've been talking about this really deep, deep thought that I had. And I know it blew your mind in week one. But this like really deep revelation was life is hard. I know. Raven's like, no way. No, of course not. Life is hard and life is not easy. I think we're having a better, theological understanding of what it means to follow Jesus. And that even though we follow Jesus, it doesn't mean that life is going to be perfect and great all the time. No, it actually means we get to walk with him. And again, we get to share in the suffering of Jesus Christ. And what might feel like suffering in a season or trial in a season, again, we hold tight to him. We stay low and stick to the cross so that we can have an eternity with our Father. Jesus didn't come to make life easy. He came to make life matter. And just like we said, what matters most is us being image bearers of the Father. You are created in the image of the invisible. Come on, somebody. You know that's a song right there, Ian. That one was for you. We're created in the image of the invisible God, and he has put a tag on you, calling you a son or a daughter, and you are now called to live life with a purpose. And again, the main point being that purpose, to lift his name high, amen, to make his name known, we used to say, it's not the best way of saying it, but to make his name popular. Our lives should be about him, even in the harder calls. But again, I believe the harder calls are actually bringing us life instead of leading us down a path that the Bible ultimately says is going to lead to death and destruction. I don't know how that hits you this morning, but that's actually good news. We're on the winning side. When you choose Jesus, even in the hard, you are on the winning side this morning. And so I want to continue this morning, if we can, and give you some thoughts. We know what day it is. And so I want to give you some thoughts, just understanding that not everyone is a parent in this room, a father in this room. But really, I want to keep this thought in terms of leadership in our life or parenting. The words can be synonymous this morning. Parenting or leading people in our lives. Are you guys good? Amen. The more you say amen, the more we'll beat the Baptists to the restaurant and the fathers. You fathers will be taken care of. It'll be good. We have a sense of humor. I love it. Let's pray. God, thank you so much for this morning. Again, thank you for your word. Just be with us as we are in week 3. Again, encourage us as leaders, as parents, as people who have a part to play in really where the world is at right now. And so I just pray even right now you begin to call people forward in their anointings, call people forward in their leadership in different areas and aspects of their life so that you would continue to be glorified and lifted high in our lives and in our world. In Jesus' name, everyone said amen. You might know this by now if you've been sticking around for a while. This usually happens at Christmas, but I say I'm not much of a holiday kind of guy. Yeah, I'm getting some nods up here. You know, I'm not really a big Hallmark holiday kind of guy, especially these things where it's like National Fill in the Blank Day. You guys know what I'm talking about? Like the National. You know what I mean? And some of these things are like, what are we even talking about right now? We're actually like to celebrate this. And these things are legit. And I got thinking, I was like, okay, I need to, what are some of the weirdest things that people celebrate for National Fill in the Blank Day? I just have about 6 of them. I stopped at June because I was getting tired. But January 14th, you're going to want to write these down, put these on the calendar. These ones are important, okay? National Dress Up Your Pet Day. For all those who have cats, we're just praying that evil out of your house. We're just praying it out, praying it out. February 25th, maybe if you're from the East Coast, this is cool. This is National Clam Chowder Day. Yeah. Weird. Just strange. March 11th, this is giving me big 90s vibes, National Fanny Pack Day. Okay, we got some fanny pack fans in the house. Okay. Men, write this one down. This one's going to give you points. April 25th is National Mani Pedi Day. Did I get a pedicure once? I'm not telling. May 9th, this one's going to hit hard for all the parents in the room. Everyone's going to get this one. May 9th is National Lost Sock Remembrance Day. Where do they go? Where do the socks go? And why are Zoe's socks so dirty constantly? I'll end with this one. June 2nd is National Donut Day. I celebrate this day. Can I get an amen? Can I get an amen? Yes, yeah, we celebrate this. Obviously, we could go on and on about these silly, like, national days or days that we celebrate and people lean into. But on a less gimmicky note, again, today is Father's Day. And so I want to honor all of the fathers, the spiritual fathers, like Chris has already, you know, kind of shouted out this morning, that are in the room. Can we give it up for the dads in this place this morning? Absolutely. And really, before I go on, and I promise I'll be quick, but both are not in the room this morning, unless my dad snuck in at some point. If he's here, go, all right, I'm here. All right, he's not here. That's how he talks. Probably not that bad. Or the face. What was the face about? Okay. I want to honor Pastor Brad. I have never known someone. Yeah, absolutely. I've never known someone to be so, and I've said it once, I've said it a million times, such a good pastor. He's such an amazing pastor, how he cares for people, how he'll take the time to talk with you and lead you. And even in situations like being a specific biological dad, he still has so much to pour into your family and into your marriage and into how to raise his kids. Why? Because he's sticking close to Jesus. We're going to get there. But, like, what an incredible spiritual father Brad Watson is. So when you see him, just give him a high five, give him a hug. Love on Pastor Brad this morning. And then my dad, again, he might not be here. I hope you're watching on YouTube on your 80-inch television. Feel free to let me have that. I love this. This is what I love about my dad. And, again, I've said this, and I think he'd be okay with me saying this, but my dad did not have a great dad. Anyone? So my dad didn't have a great dad, and so therefore my dad really didn't know how to be a great dad. And yet through the years, we've grown together, and we've grown up, and just to see his heart. And let me tell you, let me just slide this right in here right now. It's not too late to become a spiritual father. It's not too late to become a great dad. Because as we've grown through the years, and again, just how I see him love his wife, how I see him take care of his family, how he loves his daughter, how he loves his two sons. All three of us are very, very different, and yet he loves us, you know, the same, and I think the same. No, he loves Emma more. Yeah, that's true. But, like, I've learned through osmosis and continue to learn through osmosis just how to be a good father. And so I just want to honor those two guys. Oh, by the way, it's my dad's birthday today, too. So happy birthday to my dad. So we're going with somewhere with all of this, I promise. We got 25 minutes left. But we're going somewhere with this because leading as a parent, being a leader in general, you know, making the hard choice to be a leader in your situations and in your context, this is a hard choice to make. Amen? This is a hard choice to make. Parenting defined the process of raising children and providing them with protection and care in order to ensure their healthy development into adulthood. I want you to see that again. I want to read it again and again. I want you to take it in both as a biological, you know, dad or parent, or as a leader. The process of raising children, raising people up, and providing them with protection and care in order to ensure their healthy development into adulthood. This is what I know. There is no other thing quite like parenting. There's nothing quite like leadership, a leadership role in our lives, where the hard choices that we have to make actually have the most impact of the lives around us that we should ultimately care most about. Like where the parents in the room, I know that you would probably do anything for your kid. You would go to the moon and back for your kid. Anything that kind of comes at them or like, you know, kind of triggers them as they're learning and growing, you just want to be there for them. You want to protect them. You want to take care of them. I love that we have a good father who does the same for us. Amen. We have a good God who's constantly wanting to take care of us and grow us up and protect our hearts in such a way so that, again, we can grow in his ways, in the ways of a good father. And again, I want this to be a holistic thought this morning because we have lots of parents in the room and we have some moms and dads to be. Shout out to all the moms and dads to be. I was going to name names, but I won't. We've got some single, I don't know what I'm allowed to do, or I don't want to get in trouble. Again, we got some single people in the room, all the single ladies. We love you. And we have some junior highs that aren't allowed to date until they're 27 years old. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. That's right. Hallelujah. All the parents said, this is what I know, that every single one of us, again, you put whatever label that you want on it this morning, but every single one of us has a part to play in leading and parenting in the kingdom of God. Because I know this, is that when you say yes to Jesus, when you say yes to the hard moments of leading, God is always going to give you opportunities in your life to provide protection and care and ensure that people are living a life that is as close to Jesus as they can be. I love the fact, Jalen, I just heard your voice, so I'm just going to lean in on Jalen for a second. It's always easier to pick on him. Jalen is not a dad. Hallelujah. Get married, and then you'll figure it out. But what I love is that leadership role, that fathering heart that our father has already given him, so that when he brings people into atmospheres like this, then they go, oh, shoot, this is why he's different on another, you know, on Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday. There is something for you. There is a role to play in the kingdom of God as a parent, as a leader. And the more you stick close to Jesus, the more opportunities he's going to give you to pour into people's life. And this is a hard choice to make most times, because when you try to lead people or kids, or 41-year-olds who still don't have it all together, what you need to realize in that hard choice is it's really hard to take people to a place that you've never been. It's really hard to lead people to a place that you've never been. This is my heart, that Exchange Church would lead people closer to his heart. That Exchange Church would be known as a place where you come into an atmosphere like this and you're welcomed and you're loved on, and it doesn't matter what your yesterday looked like or what you've already planned out for tomorrow. It doesn't matter about any of that, because right now in this atmosphere, we're here to protect and love and serve and care just like the Father does for us. But could it be that God wants more from your life for your life, so that you can walk along people to places that he's calling you to be? I know that some of the hardest moments in my life where I thought, God, how are you going to use it? How are you going to redeem this? This is what we talked about in week one. This is what he's up to. He's up to the story of redemption. And so as he's redeeming your past, as he already has redeemed your future, could you begin to say, God, what is the next thing that you have for my life? What is the next step of obedience? What's the next step of faith? Maybe the hard choice that I can say yes to so that I can walk with someone tomorrow. Are you guys with me? It's a hard choice to lead. I think even as believers, it's possible to be biological fathers, but not spiritual fathers, even to our own children. I can't let Sunday mornings raise my daughter in the ways of Christ. Amen? I can't, because it's not going to work. I can't just hope that when she goes to Apple Music, she's going to play Elevation Worship instead of Doja Cat or something. Hey. Like, I have to do my part. Because even though I am her biological father, I know that she's got another father that is way more important for me and that can do way more for her than I ever can. And so I need to walk in a way that actually leads my daughter closer to the kingdom. I have to walk in step so that she can see the father. And I get it. No one knows how to be a mother or a father right off the bat. I know when Zoe was born, I actually asked her if I could like pick her up today. And she said, "Dad, no." I said, "But you're still my baby." And she said, "No." I remember in the hospital room, and Andy was pregnant. And I kind of was like in the corner, like shaking and rocking and like, "Is it almost done? Is it almost done?" And then Zoe arrived, and then I was like, "Clean that thing up." And then when I finally held Zoe in my arms, the intense fear was gone. Like, I can't even really explain it. The intense fear and that moment of uncertainty, and then I held her as her father, and this instant protection came over me. And like, can I hold her now? No! I mean, yes, just be very careful. And I remember driving home. She was born February 24th, and it was a massive snowstorm in the Niagara region. And I remember driving home, and I was on the QEW, and I was driving like 50, which probably isn't safe. But in my head, it was safe in the moment because I just wanted to go slow, and I wanted to protect her. I know that it's not... It's not like you get this miraculous download of how we're to raise up our kids right off the bat, and there's no way that you're going to get everything right. But I think one of the best ways to learn to be a parent, to be a father, to be a leader in your life, no matter what age or stage, is to continue to look to our Heavenly Father and to continue to look to His ways, to look back and see the good gifts that He has given you in forms of people. Hebrews 13:7, it says this: remember your leaders. Do you remember your youth pastor? Do you remember that person that maybe knocked on your door and said, "Hey, like, my name is so-and-so," and you developed a relationship, and then you started going to church, and because of that relationship, you now have relationship with God. Remember your leaders who taught you the word of God. Think of all the things that have come from their life and follow their example. I know that my life and my parenting and my leadership is a culmination of certain people's influences in the formative years of my life. Tons of interactions. Again, even now, still learning how to be a good father and a good husband and a good pastor. And I really think that there's so many contributing factors of how to lead or how to parent, but nothing quite adds up to the revelation of how God sees you as a son or a daughter. I will take this one to the bank. The passion, the love, the desire to get to know Him more, I really believe that comes from a revelation of how much He cares for you. We live in a world where, again, we're talking about holidays, where it's Christmas time again, and it's Easter time again, and maybe it just kind of washes over us about the things that God has done for us as a loving Father. I just wonder if we could even close our eyes and get a glimpse once again of the cross of Calvary, that a good father would send his only son so that we wouldn't perish but have everlasting life. What kind of dad gives up his own son for humanity? Ask me to do that for my child. I'm going to have a problem. I'm going to have a problem, but it's a revelation of getting to know God's heart for me. I know that the best leaders who have poured into my life knew who their father was, had a revelation of God's love for them. And so that's what they were walking in. And that's the strength that they had to pour into my life. And I realize, and I don't want to get caught up on this, and I know you've probably heard this before, but maybe there's someone in this room this morning that actually has a problem with the word father or the idea father because of who their earthly dad has been to them. I understand that, because like I said, my dad had been there. And so I bet there was some sort of tension along the way that I'm now to call God my father, but I've got holes and gaps in my heart and in my life from the things that my heavenly father did, or my earthly father did to me. So that's why I'm just calling it out. It's the importance of leadership in parenting, that we connect with God's heart on the daily so that we can lead our kids on the daily. So that we can make the hard choice, instead of just saying goodnight and giving a high five or a hug, we actually go, hey, can we stop and pray? Yeah. Can we talk about how are you seeing God these days? What's God been saying to you? I could go off on tangents just about how, like, being a 13-year-old girl, and I don't want to out her or tell her stories, but, like, there's frustration even in a 13-year-old. Come on, somebody. And it's like wild of all the things that she's dealing with and the internal frustrations that she has, and what my job is to do instead of coming alongside her and complaining with her, come on somebody, is actually say, well, Zoe, what do you think God's trying to teach you in this? What's the heart of the father for you? Again, father to child. And we're going to get there in a second. But I really want you to lean into this. I want everyone to get a clear revelation of how God loves us as his kids, and in turn we can lead and parent and give proper perspective to those in our lives that God has entrusted to us to lean into. And again, like we could have a whole, this is the thing about not having our own space. And I'm praying into it, and I'm believing that God's going to come through and show up. And as Exchange grows and we grow as a church family, man, we could have moments where we have some altar time and we're praying for one another, and we're just believing that God is going to speak and give revelation. But you don't need this atmosphere for God to speak. Can I just put it out there? Like, this holy ground is just as holy ground as your bedroom. Or your living room, or your car, even my car. Sweet Lord, if you've seen my car, I believe it in Jesus' name. God can give you revelation of how he sees you. And he can speak to your disappointments. He can speak to those gaps in your heart. He can remind you who you are and whose you are, so that, again, your heart is whole and healthy for you to lead that next generation, or for you to lead those people at work, whoever he's put in the sphere of your influence. I just got one point, and everyone said, amen. Amen. Let Christ lead. Let Christ lead you. You want to be a good leader? I know I'm a better leader when I'm letting Christ lead me. I know I'm a better parent when I'm letting the Father father me. If you want to lead well, you need to let Christ lead you. I think we can all say this morning that we could do a better job in submitting our own ways and letting Holy Spirit lead us in so many different areas of our life. So many times it's an afterthought. So many times we don't set ourselves up for success. We don't make the hard choice of waking up that 15 minutes early, getting into your word, getting into prayer, allowing God to set a foundation for your day so that you can be leaning into him, so that you can be aware. And I'm wondering if it's actually time that somebody in this church, somebody in this seat, somebody listening online actually draws a line in the sand. And we make choices again today that will help us out tomorrow. Choices that will actually lead us closer to his heart. In terms of parenting, I'm well aware of the decisions that I make are not only affecting me, but are affecting my child. She's watching me, and she's listening to me, and she's taking on my characteristics. Somebody pray for her. And the best way to ensure that she's set up for her future, hear me this morning, the best way, add this to your context, the best way to set her up for her future is to make sure that I'm letting Christ lead me. That I'm leading myself well. And that's a sobering thought because there's a lot of things, even last week, that I got wrong, that I said wrong, that I reacted to instead of responding well. Come on, somebody. We're getting honest this morning. We're getting honest this morning. And there's choices where there's times when I had the choice to be Christ-like and I've chosen the opposite. I've chosen to get angry. I've chosen to walk in my flesh. Here's just one thing. This is for the men this morning because it is Father's Day. Men, do you want to lead better in your life? Do you want to parent better? You want to be a better spouse? Genuine faith and sincerity will manifest when men are willing to admit that they are wrong. Oh, the ladies piped. Oh. The ladies piped up on that one. Literally, I am convicted. I'm just laying it all out this morning. I am convicted that genuine faith and sincerity come out of men when we apologize and we actually humble ourselves, when we actually let go of our pride and we start leading the way that Jesus led. He was a humble servant. He came in low. We talked about donkey mission. Instead of coming in on a white stallion, he comes low on a donkey. You treat your wife disrespectfully in front of your children? Apologize with your child in the room. Your apologies will communicate to them that you are serious about obedience, that you're serious about taking the right stances, the harder choices, that you are not content to continue in your sin, and that you're attempting to walk out what you teach. I want to be a better father to the little ears and the little beautiful blue eyes that are watching me lead. And I'm so convicted this week that there are gaps in her heart because of the wrong choices that I've made, the easier choices that I've made. Again, this is a room of restoration and redemption, and I believe that Zoe's going to be just great in Jesus' name. But I'm so aware that if I'm allowing Holy Spirit to help me father better and lead better, I need to look no further than the example of Jesus Christ. This is why God sent his son. This is why God sent his son. Check this out. Paul writes an example in Philippians 2, 5 to 8. And consider the example that Jesus, the anointed one, has set before us. Let his mindset become your motivation. Dang. Let his mindset, who he was, how he carried himself, let that be your motivation. He existed in the form of God, and yet he gave no thought to seizing equality with God as his supreme prize. Instead, he emptied himself, oh, it's beautiful, of his outward glory by reducing himself to the form of a lowly servant. He became human. He humbled himself and became vulnerable, choosing to be revealed as a man and was obedient. He was a perfect example. Someone say perfect. He was a perfect example. Even in his death, a criminal's death by crucifixion, I love that Paul recognizes that Jesus made his decision in advance of the cross. I'm going to say it again. Jesus made the decision to come and to serve and to be humble and to learn from his father. You remember when he like peaced out on his parents and his parents were like freaking out and they go back to the temple and they go, Jesus. Not as a curse word. Where have you been? What are you doing? And he goes, I'm just about my father's business. I'm just in here about my father's business. I'm learning about my father. I'm spending these moments with him. What a perfect example, the Bible says, that we can look to for parenting and for leadership. For what God has for us. Here's the good news. Jesus took up his physical cross so we don't have to. Jesus took up the physical cross so we don't have to, but here's the reality. He did so that we would now have the hard choice of knowing there's a greater calling than just living, than just existing, but actually choosing to become more like Christ so that we can be more effective for him in the kingdom. More than just being effective for him in the kingdom. I believe that he wants for you, that wants that for you. But he sent his son so that we could be called sons and daughters. So that we could be made right with him. And so the question here, I guess, is what parts of your life or your self-discipline or your self-leadership do you need to work on as a person or a parent to make sure that you're walking in step with who God created you to be? And we look no further than the example of Jesus Christ. He humbled himself, and in turn, we humble ourselves, and we live and we lead from the example that Christ has shown us. And it's imperative that we lead ourselves to a place where Holy Spirit is continuing. We're allowing Holy Spirit to continue to teach us. This is the model. It's like learn, teach, model. This is a biblical foundation as God taught and then his son modeled. He learned and then he modeled. We look through Jesus to see God the Father. And so as parents, we learn. Again, we have the handbook. We've got the Bible. We've got the word. And it begins to teach us. So we will model. John 14:9 says, Jesus replied, Philip, I've been with you all this time and you still don't know who I am? How could you ask me to show you the Father? For I am the one who has, for anyone who has looked at me has seen the Father. Anyone who looks at Jesus has seen the Father. Again, we believe in a Trinitarian God, Father, Son, Holy Spirit. And as God was teaching Jesus, and Jesus ultimately dies and says, it's a good thing I'm going so I can send you someone even cooler than me. Someone who's omnipresent, someone who's always there to help you and teach you and guide you. And I know this is happening even now because it happened in the past. It was modeled in the Bible for us. It's all over the Bible in lives like Elijah and Elisha and John the Baptist and in Paul the Apostle. I'm not suggesting this morning that every single parent, father, leader is perfect. That's not what I'm suggesting, far from it, but I'm suggesting that if they are effectively teaching, modeling, leaning into the Word of God, God's Son, if they're leaning into the Word and they sincerely attempt to walk it out, I really believe that the generations to come are going to be okay. I am sick and tired. Parents, hear me this morning. This is my soapbox to end. I am sick and tired of hearing that the church is doomed. I'm sick and tired of hearing that TikTok is going to grow our kids instead of the church. Is there a passion in this room to say, not my kids? They will not be taken by the enemy. They will not be taken in by the world. And listen, I know there's people sitting in this room that have children that are far away from God. And I believe right now that he is calling them home by his Spirit. I believe that by his Spirit right now, he is calling them home. And so what does it look like for exchanged people to say, what do I need to do in my life? What do I need to lean? What parts of me do I need to submit again, lean into and give over to God so that he can continue to father me and teach me and grow me so that I can be the parent, the person, the leader that he's called me to be? Could you take that home even today on Father's Day? Could you take that home and maybe wrestle that through and maybe write that down and say, hey, this is the area, God, that I want to work on in my life, that I want to submit to you, parent or not, father or not. Could you submit that to him and allow him to work on your heart, work on that situation, stand with someone, allow someone to be praying with you, walking with you? But I believe that we can choose the hard thing of becoming better parents and better leaders. Amen? Amen. Dads, we got some root beer for you outside. It's going to be cold. Ladies, we'll get some for you next week. I don't know. We only got so much. So enjoy. Happy Father's Day. We love you so much. I'm going to pray and I'm going to let you go. But God, thank you so much for this morning. Even in the conversation of parenting and what we want for our kids and how we want to see this next generation continue to grow in wisdom and in favor with you and with men. God, I pray that you'd continue to lead us first, that you'd continue to challenge us and grow our hearts, grow our capacity so that we can be the parents, we can be the people that you've called us to be. We want to be effective for your kingdom. We want to see Windsor, Essex changed for your name, that many, many people would come to know the good news of Jesus Christ. Show us those blind spots. Show us those gaps. The moments of disappointment, I pray that you would come and you would heal and you would restore. We welcome you into our thoughts and our mind space this week as we think on these things, as we pray on these things. Do what only you can do. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Love you guys. We'll see you next week.
Fail me now, you won't fail me.